believe we're still doing redirect of the plaintiff.
Just swearing again.
She's still under oath?
She's still under oath. She doesn't need to be reminded, does she?
Oh, good. Okay, I just wanted to make sure. Are you aware of the penalties of perjury?
Yes.
I'm sorry, what?
I asked her if she was aware of the penalty of perjury.
Yes.
Oh, you are?
Yes.
You testified that I've never taken the kids to swimming lessons earlier.
I'm sorry, what? Speak up, I'm sorry.
You testified that I have never taken the kids to swimming lessons.
I didn't say never.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't.
Okay. What did you say?
I said once she switched the visitation schedule, you finished the swim lessons that I paid for, and then you never took them back. The order was that whoever took them to swim lessons had to prove that they're swim safe. That was never done. You never finished the sessions after.
So you don't recall saying that I never took the kids to swimming lessons?
I didn't say never.
Yes. Okay. Okay. When Emmanuel was at swimming lessons, did you display...
I'm sorry, speak up, sir.
When Emmanuel Hall was at swimming lessons, did he display any type of anxiety or fear?
He didn't want to leave the first step. He stayed on the step the whole session. All the times I took him, he stayed on the first step.
So every time you took him, he stayed on the first step?
Yes.
Define the first step.
On the stairs, sitting down on the stairs.
On the stairs of what?
The swimming pool.
So his feet were in the water.
His whole body was in the water. He was sitting on the first step.
So he's sitting on the first step where the water comes up. So basically his hiney is in the water, but no other part of his body's in the water.
He would stay on the steps. So when the kids were playing, he would get down on all three steps. But he never went further with the lifeguard.
Oh, okay, now, there's a difference between the first step and all three steps. So it's all three steps now, right?
He would stay on the stairs of the pool.
Okay, I want to make absolutely clear.
He wouldn't go into the pool with the lifeguard.
He wouldn't go into the pool with the lifeguard?
During swim lessons. Now, when I took him to the pool any other time, he was wherever he could stand, he was in. He swims around the lazy river at Winna Wild, but he can stand.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Would you consider that response to the water trauma?
Not necessarily.
So you wouldn't consider that trauma, that child's so deathly afraid of water that he just won't go into anywhere where he can't stand up?
He didn't want to be forced to swim.
He didn't want... Say that again?
He didn't want... At that time... We're talking 2 years ago.
I asked you to repeat yourself, please. That's all.
We're talking 2 years ago. There's a whole difference.
Ma'am, there's no question pending.
I'm asking you to repeat yourself.
He's not deathly afraid of the water.
At the time, was he deathly afraid of the water?
Did you understand the question? Because I didn't.
Was he afraid of the water when you were taking him to swim lessons?
When I was taking him to...
Objection, foundation. I just want a year.
Sustained. I'm on foundation.
When you were taking him to swim lessons in 2017 in March, did he display, or January, February, March, did he display any trauma or fear, genuine fear, when he was with the swimming instructor?
He wasn't fearful of the water. He didn't want to leave the steps. He wouldn't go past his chest.
Even with an instructor?
He didn't know the instructor, so no, he didn't want to go in with the instructor.
Okay. Emmanuel was taken to Mountain View Hospital, from the records that I can see, at least twice. My question is, the first time he went to Mountain View Hospital, it shows on the record that he was dealing with respiratory issues.
Objection, foundation.
Foundation, what's the foundation?
The date.
The date? Okay, in 2018, he was taken to Mountain View Hospital twice. From a 4-H incident.
Is that a question? Is that a question?
Yes.
It wasn't specifically from a 4-H activity.
Was he at 4-H, or did you leave 4-H and go to the hospital?
Yes.
So he became, had started having troubles when he was at 4-H, is that correct, yes or no?
He was at 4-H, but it was on a windy day and we were in the open field in the arena. So it wasn't anything to do with the animals, it was the wind blowing the hay around.
Las Vegas has a lot of wind.
Yes, it does.
Does he ever get sick any other time? Every single time, it seems as though he's been at 4-H when he gets this.
No,
an ejection, he's testified.
Okay, sorry about that. Let me rephrase it. Have you ever taken him to the hospital, Emmanuel, for a respiratory breathing problem when he was not at 4-H?
No, I have a breathing machine at home that I can give him breathing treatments with, and he has an asthma inhaler, and and at that time he was prescribed allergy medication.
So basically what you're saying to me is the only time he's ever gone to the hospital was from 4-H.
Objection, not exactly what
you're saying. Overruled.
No. He has an asthma inhaler.
The two times that you took him to the hospital, did he come from 4-H, yes or no?
Yes, but he has asthma.
You said just a minute ago that he has an asthma inhaler.
Yes.
And he has a nebulizer.
Yes.
When did you get the nebulizer?
About a year and a half ago.
A year and a half ago.
I don't carry my nebulizer around in my car.
Are you absolutely sure you got it a year and a half ago?
It's an estimation. I don't know exactly when I got it.
Your Honor, I'm going to object. It's a renewed objection. He's well beyond the scope of my cross-examination. He's into new territory.
What's the scope?
Are we in his case in chief?
Yes.
Then he started it.
Correct. I've crossed. You allowed some outside the scope because you found it relevant, but now we're entering entirely new areas of direct examination.
Actually, no. This has come up before as an issue.
Okay. Okay.
Look.
What's the scope? So I don't screw this up?
If I thought the line of questioning was going to be going far beyond, but in terms of your examination about her ability to care for the children and see to their needs, arguably within the scope of cross.
Okay. And just to make a record.
I know.
Okay. He's now bringing up Mountain View Hospital that was never part of either direct or cross. So
by name, yes, that you're correct.
Okay, I'm done. What's the scope?
She just said.
Keep going, sir, and I'll tell you when you've gone too far.
Okay.
times that he's had respiratory problems, you said you were at home? And you used your nebulizer at home?
I used my nebulizer at home.
Okay. And how many times would you say you've used it over the past 3 years?
Probably about 5 or 6 times.
5 or 6 times? Have you noticed a pattern of when you have to use it?
No. We live in... That's Dr. Claude.
You live in where?
We live in Las Vegas, where it's windy.
Wait a minute. We have somebody who entered the room. And insofar as he is going to be testifying, he can't stay in the room. Mr. Grimes, you want to invoke the exclusionary rule?
Dr. Claude,
can we cut her and then get him?
I'll waive it. And Your Honor, we've discussed this in between to save time, etc. For Dr. Claude. If it's not an imperative section, we will suspend the testimony to get Dr.
All right, we'll suspend this for now. And for the record, who's calling him? Okay.
You do solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give in this action shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
Yes, sir.
Sir, could you please state your name?
I'm Dr. Kindele Emmanuel Collade.
Okay. And what is your business address?
I'm a child psychiatrist and a psychiatrist, board certified by the state of Nevada.
Okay, you are going to have to speak up.
Oh,
and I say this with as much respect as I can possibly give because you deserve it. You have a little bit of an accent.
Yes, I do. Thank you. I'm sorry.
And I don't mean any disrespect. We're a country of immigrants. However, because of that, and because I'm kind of stuffed up, my ears are a little bit plugged, could you try very hard to speak slowly and very succinctly so that I can hear you?
Yes, I will try.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Your Honor, I just want to renew my objection to this witness, not disclosed. I've actually gone back and looked at the pretrial memorandums. He's never listed. I know it was previously addressed, but I want the record clear, so I'm just renewing my objection.
Then the court calls Dr. Collette. Is that fair enough?
That creates new problems, but okay.
I want to hear from him.
I understand.
I don't know that it necessarily prejudices either party. And sometimes, just a little point, Mr. Grimes, sometimes we should think about when we object and when we really don't want to.
And, Your Honor, I understand that, but I have information that isn't always available in here, and because of the likelihood of an appeal coming out of this case, the Supreme Court, while it has overturned judges, it often admonishes lawyers who waive objections during the time of trial. And so while I agree with the court that some of this I would not object to if I didn't believe it was going to be appealed, I must preserve my objection so
and
that I don't get
your objection, sir, is duly noted. And feel free to make this argument, but I will make a record right now just so you understand. When the trier of fact is trying to make a determination, relevant information is helpful to the trier of fact to get a sense of what is in the best interest of two minor children. I would prefer to err on the side of sufficient information. I think there are a lot of considerations I have to make, and I do think having this witness testify frees you up, Mr. Grimes, as well, to inquire as to the events that gave rise to his retention as well as his resignation. So insofar as I do not believe that there is any overriding prejudice, frankly, to either party, and insofar as I finally have somebody who's a professional that has actually met one of the children, that may well be of assistance to the court to get a sense of at least one of those boys so that I can help him and make sure that his best interests are duly served.
Thank you.
That's my record.
Thank you.
And if the Supreme Court wants to reverse me on it, or the appellate court, because it's clear error, I don't agree. I think that this is a witness, I think, who is important to this case. So, Mr. Hall, you
yes,
have called him, so I guess you're going to start direct examination.
Yes, Your Honor. Do I get to start? Your Honor, this is the record that I received in court from his attorney. I want him to see it, the proof that it is actual, the actual record.
Well, I don't know if I can let you if Mr. Grimes hasn't seen it.
Oh, I have not been provided a copy of these, and I was in the hearing where they were provided, and he's had adequate time to submit them to my office.
So. Then I guess they're not coming in.
Okay.
I take it that's an objection that I sustained.
I,
unless you wanted to come in. Again, Mr. Grimes,
I
you have to make that decision. I don't know if it harms or helps your client, frankly. We'll get to you soon enough, sir.
Your Honor, I have no objection to these documents being admitted.
Okay, do I have a copy?
I am going to want a copy.
Let's make two copies before he asks the witness about it.
Dr. Collati.
Wait.
Yes, ma'am.
We're not going any further until we all have copies of what is, I suppose, do you have any exhibits that you've submitted to my clerk? So I guess it's Exhibit A.
Well, Your Honor, there are A is already in. He has two books he's submitted.
Oh, A is already in?
And
all right, then it's Exhibit next in order.
Yeah.
Okay, you need to mark it. Okay, thank you. Let me read this for a moment. I'm a very fast reader, I assure you. Thank you. much, I read fast. Proceed, Mr. Hall. Waiting.
Dr. Collati, to the best of your recollection from what you're looking at right now, is this the record of Emmanuel Hall?
Yes, it's the record from my office. The one I was.
Yes, your office provided. When I came into your office originally, I've been in your office like six times. When I came to your office originally, I gave some paperwork.
Sir, please, you're testifying.
I'm sorry. When I came into your office, did I leave some paperwork for you from other physicians concerning this patient?
Yes, you did.
To the best of your recollection, what did the paperwork state concerning when the child was with the father versus with the mother?
Objection, calls for hearsay.
Sustained.
Gosh, I suck at being a lawyer. I didn't love this job. When you were looking at the other doctor's, the other doctor's paperwork, is it normal that that paperwork is then included into the record or your file, this file in particular?
Normally, we verify where the records come from. If it comes from a doctor's office, yes, we do include it in the patient's file.
I'm sorry, speak up, sir.
Yes, normally when we verify that the record is from another physician's office, we normally include those records in the patient's file.
Oh, you do. Okay. Okay, so is that record in this file?
Some of them are here in the file that I brought, not the one you gave me now.
Okay, okay. Is this the file that your attorney provided me?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
What file you have in mind?
Okay. I'm a mechanic. I'm not a lawyer, so I think of
how
things.
How can I help you?
I think of things in mechanics terms. So if a car is doing something and then it's not doing something at different time, I try to diagnose the problem. Oh, well, it's obviously not this because it's not doing this when it's cold or whatever the circumstance is. The letters that you got from the other doctors, do you have
everything
them in the
you
file?
Just said is stricken because I don't understand it and it's clogging the record.
Okay, I didn't mean to clog the record. What I'm trying to say is it unusual for a patient to act one way in one circumstance or with one parent and totally different in another way with another parent? Is that normal?
I don't know what is normal, but people do exhibit different behaviors in different situations differently.
Did you find it in your letter, it's on the front of the file, strike that question. Was the information that you were given from the two other, one medical physician and one HBI, Human Behavioral Institute, Vince Rodriguez, were they instrumental in any way in you taking the course of action of removing the child from your care?
If I understand you correctly, you gave me this information after the fact. You told me to stop treating your son the same day you brought those documents. And you wanted a letter specifically from me to you, and you are significant other, that all treatment should be stopped, and we did that duly. I've not reviewed those records to make any decision. It was based on what you wanted.
Did I mention Judge Pomerantz at all when I was in your court, when I was in your office?
I don't recall. It calls for hearsay.
No, it doesn't.
Withdrawn.
I don't recall you threatened to subpoena records, and I asked you specifically how I could help you. You were not being forthcoming. You were just being.
I'm sorry, what?
He threatened for subpoenas. I didn't understand what he needed from me. I asked him to ask me specifically what he needed. He said he wanted the records of his child's treatment and that all treatment should be stopped immediately. And we stopped. And he also wanted a letter to that effect provided to him and to his significant other, and we gave him the same. And that was the extent of my interaction with him until he came back later with a subpoena.
My next question is, are you the author of the prescription guafenamine for Emmanuel Hall?
I don't know what that means. I prescribed him Tenex.
Tenex. Is the generic name for it guafenamine or something
the
like
that? The generic name for Tenex is guanfenazine.
Did you provide the prescription for the Tenex?
Yes, I prescribed that medication for your son, his mother.
Okay. Do you remember when I was in your office asking you who prescribed it?
I told you it was myself, yes. And I have 3, 4, 5 prescriptions I wrote for your son. And we talked about it, and you said you didn't want him to take any medicine.
Oh, okay. Do you still feel, were you surprised to see the letters from Human Behavioral Institute and from Dr. Habibi from St. Rose Pediatrics? Were you surprised to see that the child does not act out in any way when he's with his father?
I don't understand your question. The same day you brought these papers to me was the day you asked me to stop treatment. I'm sorry, after I stopped treatment, I didn't have any reason to go back to look at those papers.
Oh, okay.
Let me try to help a little bit. Once Mr. Hall asked you to stop treating Emmanuel, you stopped treating him.
Correct.
And sent the letter. Because you were stopping treating Emmanuel, did you review any of the documents that Mr. Hall gave you?
No.
Okay. Now I think I understand.
Okay. So you didn't review any of those documents at
you,
all?
You provided me with a whole lot of documents, including court record of your wife, criminal records, things that were totally unrelated to treating your son, and you wanted everything stopped immediately. And I had to listen to you. I stopped, and I gave you the letter you wanted, and that was the extent of me moving forward. And I also asked you if you need further help concerning your son, that we were available to help.
Were you, are you aware of a meeting I had with one of your providers in your office previous to me meeting with you?
I was out of the country. I was told you came to the office many, many times, and you called several times. They asked you to wait till I come back from out of the country.
Were you, are you aware of a meeting I had with one of your nurse practitioners explaining the medication and the protocols with the medication?
I'm not familiar with it.
Objection to form. I don't understand the question. Can you rephrase that?
Well, he didn't. Okay.
All right.
Tenex is it a blood pressure, also used in blood pressure medication as well?
What is the name of the medication? I thought it was Xanax. What is it?
Tenex is guanfenazine, but we
can
use
it. Can you spell
it,
for me, please?
T-E-N-E-X.
Thank you. I wrote down Xanax.
No.
I'm not a doctor.
We use it to treat children with ADHD, including pediatricians, in combination with other medications. And we provided you with that information.
Yes.
And, the risk, the benefit, the potential side effects, and other alternatives. So what specifically is your question so I can help you?
My question is, Tenex and whatever you call it.
The same thing, guanfenazine.
Yes.
What is it?
The generic name is called guanfenazine. The brand name is called Tenex.
Okay, and what is it used to treat?
They use it to treat ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder in children.
Would you say Tenex is a last resort medication?
No, it's not a last resort medication. And there are several options to treat attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. That was among the ones that I discussed with the mother who gave consent to proceed with treatment.
How long was he on Tenex?
I'm not sure how long you allowed him to take the medicine, but I saw him in my clinic between July and November last year when you came in for the first time. That was the first time I saw you. You told us to stop treatment immediately.
So he had been taking it since July.
I'm not sure if he's been taking it at home, but I prescribed for him for the 5 visits he came to my office.
Okay. So as far as you know, it was prescribed, and if it was taken according to prescription, it would have been from July to November.
I did prescribe those medication. I'm not sure if you took them.
Okay. My next question, you're not sure if he took them?
I don't live with the child, I'm sorry.
Oh, I see what you're saying. I understand. Please forgive me. Tenex has a very unusual, from what I understand about Tenex. Oh, I can't do that. That's testifying. Does Tenex have a cessation way that you take a person off of Tenex if they've been on it for an extended period of time? Is there something with that particular medication that has to be done where they come off of it slowly, or can you just cut it right off from where it is?
It depends, Mr. Hall. It depends. Everything depends on circumstances, situations.
I'm sorry, what?
It depends. Everybody's different. It depends on circumstances. If there's a side effect that is potentially dangerous to self or dangerous, you can stop it immediately. If it's not acutely necessary to stop it at once, you could taper it off. Everything depends. Everybody's different. It also depends on if the child has other medical problems. It also depends if the child has other medication that they're taking. Everybody's different. So,
do you remember me discussing with you that Emmanuel was having trouble breathing at school?
No.
No?
When you came to my office again, you identified yourself as the father. You were more interested in telling us about the criminal history of the mother and that there was nothing wrong with the child. You wanted the medicine stopped immediately. And we obliged to your request. You wanted a letter sent to you and to the mother immediately, and we did that.
Okay. Would you have prescribed this medication had you had this additional information from Dr. Habibi from St. Rose Pediatrics?
Yes.
And from St. Rose and from
Yes, definitely would have.
You would have.
Yes. Your child is not the only child that takes that medicine there. I have over 500 children I see.
And you have what?
His Emmanuel is not the only child I see. I have over 500 children in my practice that I see and in the combination with those medicines as well. So it's not the only child that takes that medicine for ADHD. And the standard practice everywhere in the United States, every doctor that treats children with ADHD would prescribe that medicine as well.
Oh, okay. So you would prescribe that medication even if a child was not acting out whatsoever in the care of one parent, but they are acting out in the care of another?
The history that I got from the mother and from the child in my office gave me an indication that the child has ADHD. And I had reasonable evidence to
prescribe
that. And yes, I amend that recommendation to the mother, and the mother agreed that we should prescribe the medication, and we went ahead and prescribed the medication.
Did the mother give you any information from the other doctor stating that the child does not act out with the father?
No, normally what happens is we ask if the child is being seen by other providers, and then the parents normally would give a consent to reach out to other providers, and then we send letters to those other providers and wait for those other providers to send us any records that they have. In case of your son, like I explained to you, we never had any of those records back from other providers. You were the one that brought them in the way you want the treatment started.
Okay. All right. So even if I had come into your office before you started treating Emmanuel, you would still have issued this medication, even if you knew from two other providers that the child was not acting out when they were with their father.
Objection asked and answered. Repeatedly.
Let me rephrase the question. So
let me ask you that. Other two providers, are they child psychiatrists or what are they, by the way?
One is Human Behavioral Institute.
No. What kind of qualification do they have? What are they?
It's a psychiatric facility.
No, are they child psychiatrists or are they just regular doctors or therapists?
I don't know, but all I know is this.
Okay, that's what I wanted to know.
I don't know, but I do know HBI, Human Behavioral Institute, is a...
Sir?
Oh, that's testifying, sorry.
Gosh, darn it.
Sorry. So I can't answer this question, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Tricky way of doing this. Did she provide you the information that the children were being seen by HBI and by St. Rose Pediatric at all when she came in?
She possibly would have mentioned that the child was seen by other providers, but not in the context of the issues that brought the child to my clinic. And most children see pediatricians, most children see all kinds of doctors for different reasons. So. My guess is the mother did explain to me all those things. It depends on the question I asked her.
Did you receive an email from me afterwards?
Lack of foundation there.
Did you receive an email from me after you sent out this letter that's in front of you? Did you receive a response to this via email?
What was it again? I'm not sure. I understand what you mean. You asked us to stop treatment. We did.
No,
I don't know.
No,
what
I,
was the reasoning for you?
I understand. This is the question. The question is very simple. On the front page, I wrote this letter. You wrote this letter.
Yes.
Okay. Now, the question I have is this. Did you receive a response from me via email for this letter?
No, I don't recall. I don't recall.
Very relevant.
Your Honor, objection, relevance, anything after he stopped treating is not relevant to the testimony today. And the well-being of the children.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Claudia. Thanks for coming in.
If you don't have questions, I do.
I do.
Okay, good.
Dr. Claudia, first of all, nice afternoon. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
So, Kaladi, where did you do your undergraduate study?
Where do you want to start?
Beginning.
Czechoslovakia.
Okay. And your medical school?
Czechoslovakia.
And ultimately, did you do a residency in child psychology?
I did my residency in the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, and then I did my post-residency called... specialty course in University of Miami.
I'm sorry, what?
A subspecialty in children in University of Miami.
And are you currently board certified?
I'm board certified, yes.
In Nevada?
In child, in adolescent, in addiction, and in
You are board certified?
In four fields. Child psychiatry, adolescent psychiatry, adult psychiatry, and addiction medicine.
And to be clear, you're an MD, not a PhD.
I'm an MD,
okay.
Right.
So you have the ability to not just assess, but to diagnose and make clinical diagnosis as well, correct?
Yes, correct.
Okay. I am looking at, on defendant, or yeah, defendant's exhibits that have been provided to you. I am looking at the page dated October 11th, 2018. It's approximately, it is on the fifth page. Can I ask you to turn to that?
October what, please?
October 11th, 2018.
Yes.
Okay, and that's your notes for your treatment on Emmanuel Hall, is that correct?
This is my encounter form.
Okay.
But October 11th, I did see the child right here.
Okay.
I have it not correct.
Are you, now, looking at what's been provided as an exhibit, does that contain your signature or your initial name?
This is my name.
Okay. And I'm looking at this page here.
Oh, yes. Yes, that's my signature, correct.
And that's your signature.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Above that, under diagnosis,
yes.
Have you diagnosed Emmanuel as having ADHD?
Yes, I did.
Okay. Is the use of Tenix an appropriate treatment for a child with ADHD?
Yes, it's the standard of care.
Okay. So what would happen if a doctor prescribes Tenix, and 5 days a week the prescription is given correctly, and on the weekends it's denied, how would that affect a child?
It all depends on the symptoms that the child was taking the medication for could resurface. That's one. Subsequently, the child could have, all depends. Like I said earlier, it depends on what other comorbid, meaning if the child has other issues, be it medical or allergies, and sometimes nothing happens, unfortunately.
Okay.
Unfortunately. So.
Is there also a percentage where it increases the side effects, such as tiredness, exhaustion, and depression?
Yes. Every single medication, including vitamins, have side effects.
And can the sudden removal of that medication and then the retreatment,
yes,
exacerbate those side effects?
It could do that. Tenix is also known to possibly cause irritability and headaches if withdrawn suddenly.
I'm sorry, what did you say?
It could cause irritability and agitation if stopped immediately.
Oh, okay. So my other question, could it affect a child with asthma?
With what?
With asthma.
I'm not sure. There's a possibility it could. I'm not certain.
Okay. Now, again, going to these exhibits, can I get you to turn to your handwritten page? It's the fourth page.
Yes.
Are those your notes?
These are my notes, correct.
So that is your handwriting, is this correct?
Correct, this is my handwriting.
What do these notes reflect?
November 14, 2018, at 2:19 p.m., father report that mother did not give me enough information. He claims that mother is a convicted felon for child abuse and neglect with substantial body harm. He claims that the death of their two-year-old son was as a result of the mother's problem. Claims that his children were sexually molested by two homosexual men when at placement at DCFS. Per father, child does not have any psychiatric issues when with him. Father claims mother maltreating the child and calling him names. Father claims and want to stop all medications. And should I read on, please?
No. Was was there anything in your notes that indicated that the defendant wanted you to have additional information about the medical history of Emmanuel?
No, the judge wanted me to stop.
And did you do what was requested?
I did exactly what he wanted.
And do you believe that was in the best interest of Emmanuel?
Given the fact that he persistently called the office and demanded that all medicine be stopped, and when I asked him how the child was doing, he said the child was fine with him. Given the fact that he assured me that the child was doing well, I had no reservation than to stop treatment.
Okay. How many times did you meet with the man?
About 4 to 5 times, approximately, within between July and November 2018.
Are you comfortable in stating today that your diagnosis of ADHD was medically appropriate for Emmanuel?
Yes, at that time, correct.
Okay. And do you still believe that a child suffering from ADHD should, in fact, be medicated if necessary?
I do believe so.
Okay.
Because it would help them academically, socially, and so that they could grow up to be their best potential.
And again, dealing with hypotheticals, if you have a student who is struggling academically, specifically in certain areas, and a medical diagnosis of ADHD, does that increase your certainty that medication is appropriate?
Correct.
Okay. Nothing further. Redirect.
I have a couple of questions. I figure I'll ask them now, maybe that will assist the parties a little bit. There's a reference to Dr. Kenneth Misch in one of these records. Let me see if I can find it. And I ask that because I am aware that Dr. Misch is a pediatrician. Let me see if I can find it. None of these pages are numbered. I gotta figure out where I found it. Ah, here. It's in the eligibility summary. And it describes Kenneth E. Misch as the PCP, which I assume is primary care physician. Let me see if I can count the number of pages. Page 10. Do you see that?
I'm afraid, from the record, you gave me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Go to page 10.
All right. I'm not numbered.
It says eligibility summary on top.
Okay.
I assume this is a document that your staff would have prepared.
I'm there.
Okay. And if you look down under the term PCP, which I would assume is primary care physician, there is a name, Kenneth E. Misch. And three lines down from that, it says St. Rose Pediatrics.
Correct. I've seen
okay.
that. Yes.
Do you have any knowledge as to whether or not Dr. Misch referred Emmanuel to your office?
I'm not aware of that.
Okay. So this would not tell me whether he did?
No.
Okay, okay.
This
that's
is
simply, that's simply a Medicaid document.
This is insurance, trying to verify insurance.
Okay. Now, how did you diagnose Emmanuel as having ADHD? What did you do?
Based on the information the mother gave me, and mostly.
What did you observe, Emmanuel?
It's a long time ago. Yes, I did observe the child in the
okay.
clinic. Yes.
And
the mother did also mention to me that the child has a previous diagnosis of ADHD based on the treatment that he got from other providers. At the Human Behavioral Institute.
Okay, so the mother told you there had been a prior diagnosis out of Human Behavioral Institute. Human Behavioral Institute?
Correct. And the primary reason she came to me was for medication management, not to re-diagnose the child.
Okay, but you didn't get any records directly from HBI, did you?
I did not get any direct record from HBI, but we did ask for those records.
Did you observe Emmanuel?
Yes.
Okay.
To diagnose ADHD, just to answer your question, you don't have to count only on your current observation. It's based on three observations, sometimes, from school, from previous treatment providers, and from the parent.
Did you have any, other than the representations by the plaintiff, the mother, did you have any other information that would have assisted you in making this diagnosis?
I got all the information I needed, I got it from the mother.
What?
All the information I needed, the mother provided me.
Okay, did you get any school records or anything?
Not at that visit, but she probably was requested.
Did you observe Emmanuel and his behaviors?
Yes.
Okay, and other than the mother's representations, what behaviors did Emmanuel exhibit that caused you to diagnose ADHD?
If you don't mind me, I want to explain a little bit more. When we make a first encounter with a patient, we require continuous monitoring so that we finish our evaluation. The reason I had the mother come back every 1 month was for me to finish my assessment to see if this is really a ADHD or if there's other things involved.
Okay.
That was the reason for continuous.
So let me ask you a question.
Yes.
Did you put Emmanuel on 10X after the first visit?
I have to check. Possibly yes.
Okay. Even though you still were diagnosing him?
But that's not uncommon. Correct.
Okay. Well, then let me ask this way. If it turned out that Emmanuel did not have ADHD, because sometimes you get a rambunctious kid, if it had turned out after a series of observations that the child really didn't have it, is there any harm with him taking the drug until the final determination is made?
No harm. And that was why I provided the mother with the risk, the benefit, alternatives, and informed consent. The mother wanted immediate relief from the symptoms she was having. That's why we prescribed the medicine. Yes, to answer your question, there would be no side effect or harm for discontinuing the medicine if at some point there's a determination that the child does not have.
But okay, so if he did have it and he was on, if he didn't have ADHD and was on the medication, it would not cause him great suffering.
No, ma'am.
Okay.
No, you have not.
And over the course of the number of visits, did you observe any changes in Emmanuel as a result of taking 10X?
The changes in what aspect? Because we.
In behavior.
Behavior. The mother said he was doing well. And that's how we base it from, because the mother had a month to observe the child at home. When the mother comes back to the clinic, we ask, those symptoms that the child came with, are they still there? The mother said no, or they're getting better. That's
okay.
How we make those determinations, based on information from the parents.
And I understand what you're saying, but what I'm trying to get at is you have a self-reporting parent,
correct?
Okay. What I need to know is whether you relied exclusively on the self-reporting parent.
Plus historical information she provided me.
Okay.
Correct.
Did she give you any pieces of paper, any documentation?
The child or the mother, please.
In other words, what I'm trying to understand is how we got from point A to point B. So please bear with me on this.
I'm yours.
No. All right. The mother brings Emmanuel in. He's at that time a 7-year-old kid, right?
Correct.
And she tells you about his behavior at home. She said he'd had a prior diagnosis of ADHD, and she was concerned about his ability to do what he needs to do. Did Did she bring the manual with her?
She brought the child with her, correct, yes.
Okay, and was the child acting out at all in your office?
ADHD has three components. One of them is inattentiveness, the other one is being hyper. My guess is when I look at the child, probably exhibited any of those.
Was he was exhibiting those behaviors?
Yeah, I did write here on my notes when I first saw the child.
So you told the mother, let's try him on 10X and see if that helps.
Correct.
Okay, knowing that he was going to come in, back in about a month.
Correct.
Okay. So, a month later, she brings Emmanuel in. She informs you that his behavior has been improving.
Correct.
And did you observe personally any change in Emmanuel since the first time
Correct.
You saw
him? Correct. That's why I had in my progress note that he was doing much better.
Okay. And then you saw them a third time.
Correct.
And again, you got the same report from the mother. Yes?
Correct.
And you observed Emmanuel, and he seemed to be more attentive and less fidgety.
Correct.
Okay. So you continued on until the until the child's father came in, and you didn't want to get stuck in a family dispute. Is that pretty fair to say?
At that point, I didn't know there was a family dispute.
I understand.
That's bad, but when the... From what the father was telling him, from the document he brought, realized that this was a lot of family dispute, and he said, the father, I want it stopped now.
Okay. And again, yeah. I'm not a doctor, I never played one on TV, but I have to ask you this question. The mother brings the child in. Did you ask any questions about the father?
Oh, yes.
And what
yes.
did...
The mother said... you don't mind me reading from what I wrote, please?
No, I appreciate it.
Per mother, parental divorce causing strife at home.
There was what?
Per mother, parental divorce causing strife at home.
Where is that?
That was on my first evaluation, July 19, 2018. It was the first sentence, basically.
And I'm not seeing it, that's why I'm kind of asking about it. Did the mother tell you that she and the father had joint decision-making power?
I don't recall specifically that question.
Now, let's assume that ever since Mr. Hall's visit to you, Emmanuel has not been on 10X. Would you expect him to continue to display symptoms of ADHD or resume this?
No. There's a therapy component as well, which I understand Emmanuel was ongoing participating. So therapy also could help reduce some of those symptoms.
Well, let me ask you a question. You might see a child who's diagnosed with ADHD. You're aware that there is a great deal of chaos in the home life between the mother and the father, right?
Correct.
Let's assume for the sake of discussion that those parents and the chaos. Would the child continue to exhibit symptoms of ADHD?
The child could exhibit a whole lot of other symptoms due to parental separation or divorce. So not just ADHD was this child having. I do remember, I just have it written, when the mother came in, she explained to me that the child also had what is called oppositional defiant disorder as well as tantrums.
Dr. Cody, do you have more information than what I have?
This is what my first evaluation, the first time I saw it in my office, what I wrote.
I mean, do you have, other than this written, handwritten thing from November?
Yes.
Do do you have anything else in
there? Yes, I have all my progress notes and all my encounters with the child.
Okay, that I haven't seen and haven't been produced.
I have all my encounters with the child and the mother.
Okay. That's why you're referring to matters that aren't before the court. Counsel, Mr. Hall, stop right there. Are you asking, good, bad, or indifferent, that the court have a complete copy of Dr. Collati's records?
Yes, Your Honor, yes.
I understand.
I have no objection to it.
All right, Dr. Collati, I'm going to ask, because you've now testified from documents that are not in front of the court, that you're going to be compelled to provide those documents for copying and have them made an exhibit.
Definitely, yes.
I just didn't have those provided, and you were making references to things that weren't in front of me. So let's have them in front of me.
Your Honor, I would ask, because of the sensitive nature of it, that
we're going to make it a confidential.
That they are confidential.
They're going to be defendant's confidential exhibit M.
Perfect.
Okay. So they will get left side filed.
And all parties are admonished not to
disclose
them publicly or otherwise.
Fair enough.
Thank you. Absolutely.
I think that'll answer a lot of questions, including that Mr. Hall may have.
And Your Honor, with this, because we're into private notes, that's a good point. Much of this has showed up on YouTube. This portion, we are simply asking that this portion where we're talking about psychiatric health of a minor, this part be
specifically ordered not to be disclosed publicly. In fact, I'm going to order the parties at the close of today, after everybody's had a chance to review them, to provide all copies back to the court.
Okay.
They're totally in camera except for purposes of this trial.
Yes.
Fair enough. Let's go get copies.
Your Honor, I hate to do it. Can we take a 5-minute break?
We're going to have to anyway. Sure, okay. Let's go off the record.